Welcome to my new series. I've decided to call it Market Adventures because that's exactly what it is. I'm gonna hit up wet markets, food markets, hopefully all over the world, and have an adventure. I'm the first to admit that I don't always shop at wet markets because supermarkets, delivery, they make it so convenient to get ingredients. But when I really want to cook a big meal and use local ingredients in the place that I am in, I always go to the wet market, and I always find that I'm so inspired. Also, the stall owners, they're so knowledgeable. It's just a really fun experience, and I know people my age, not that I'm so young, but people my age tend to get intimidated by the markets. So I want to inspire you to go to these markets, talk to the stall owners, be inspired, and cook up a storm. So the idea is that I will go to a food market or a wet market. If there's food available, definitely, obviously, I'm going to eat something. Then I'll have a look at the ingredients, see what I find interesting, inspiring, and then I'll cook a meal. And hopefully, this idea can take me all over the world because markets are a great way to get to know the place that you're visiting, the ingredients that are available, the kind of food, the smells, the flavors of that place. But before we travel, I'm going to do me the OG wet market because this is the one I grew up with. I grew up 10 minutes walk away, and this is Bukit Timah Hawker Centre and Bukit Timah Market. Sadly, this is going to be gone in a few months' time because it's all going to be redeveloped, as is usually the case in Singapore. You can't get too attached to any physical places. So, first episode, let's go. Like many market hawker center combinations in Singapore, this is organized with the cooked food on top and the raw ingredients on the bottom. And I really like that because I always imagine that the hawker stalls, they get their ingredients from downstairs, which I'm sure a lot of them do, maybe not all of them. But it's that like ecosystem of ingredients and cooking that I really love about markets. Okay, first, let's go check whether the very famous carrot cake stall is open. This is probably the most famous stall here. When I was a kid, my mom and I would always come and take away, and we would have to wait 45 minutes for a portion, but it was worth it because it's really good. Well, this laksa is very good also. Should we have laksa? Yeah, laksa. Eh, I've gone too far. I'm lost.
I don't know how travel people in you. I can't analyze it.
Eh, where's that? Oh no, it's closed. Okay, so the famous carrot cake is closed, but that's okay because that's going to force us to eat some different food, not just like the standard classics. So let's explore. Hi.
How are you?
Morning.
Morning.
Yes, having here two bowls yes. With ham. Are you Terry?
Terry is my dad.
Oh, Terry is your dad. Wow, awesome. How long have you guys been here?
10 years.
Because I grew up here, but then this store wasn't open back then.
Yeah.
Yeah. If not, I come here a lot. Okay, some Terry Katong Laksa, and this, if you don't know laksa, it's kind of a curry coconutty broth with noodles inside. It's quite seafoody, it has the flavor of dried seafood, but it's also got fresh seafood like prawns and cockles. It has some cockles. If you're in the no ham, no cockles gang, please check yourself, okay? But it has some cockles, and this is Katong Laksa. Proper katong laksa, which means, as you can see, there's no chopsticks involved. The idea is that the noodles are really short, so you can eat it with just a spoon. So the man that I bought these from is Freddy, who is the son of Terry, easy to remember. And his laksa is a lot creamier, a lot paler in color than laksa outside, but once you stir the sambal in, that should give a hit of flavor. Mm. Yum! That's really, really good. It has a really clean taste, but it's still got that coconut creaminess, the spiciness of the sambal, and that hum of that seafood flavor. This stall actually only opened after I had started living elsewhere, so it's not a stall that I grew up with. Now that I'm getting to taste it, I've just found out from Freddy that this stall is not going to the temporary market, the new market across the street, and he's going to be moving to the CBD, which means that this delicious bowl of laksa is going to be lost from this area, which is very sad, but I'll enjoy it for now. That is a very good start to the day. Let's eat some more. Water Kai Tui, sorry. I feel like this one I definitely have to get because this is super nostalgic for me. My Ipoh, my grand aunt who I grew up with and I love so much, she loved this dish and we always tap out or took this away for her at home. And when I was a kid, I never appreciated it because it's kind of an acquired flavor. Satay bee hoon is rice vermicelli with rehydrated dried cuttlefish, kangkong, which are vegetables, topped with satay sauce, which is like a peanutty spicy sauce. And I never appreciated it, so now I want to eat it in memory of her. Oh, 6块的 satay bee hoon, 但是我不要9个哦。
Smells
like a
bucket.
So what we have here is the rice vermicelli. We've got some prawns, some tofu puffs, some kangkong, some sliced pork, bean sprouts, and of course, all of that sauce. Oh no! It's okay. Brown is a very good color to wear to eat food like this. I've ordered this without the cuttlefish because I'm just not a fan. Some things will never change. The satay sauce was almost mellow. It's like creamy from the peanut flavor. It's not very spicy, but it has that spice hint and it coats the noodles really well while all the other ingredients give a nice bit of texture. This dish, satay bee hoon, is actually kind of an endangered creature because it's just a really old-fashioned dish. That stall has been open since 1965. And a lot of people in older generations in Singapore love this dish, they remember it. But somehow it's just fallen out of favor with a lot of younger people. It's not that easy to find in hawker centers in this country. So to eat this, it feels really special. And it also really reminds me of my Ipoh. She really helped to bring me up. And she was one of my kind of guides when it came to food because she loved to eat everything. She was never a picky eater. And every time my mom and I would walk to this hawker center to buy food home, we would say, what do you want? And she would say, tin tai. That's like her catchphrase, tin tai, whatever, it's fine. But we knew she loved this, so whenever we chose this, even though she didn't ask for it, she was very happy. And so eating this right now is making me very happy because coming to this hawker center does remind me of my childhood, just automatically, because we spent a lot of time here buying food, eating food. So it's nice to have a little flashback to my Ipoh.
I want 2杯豆浆冷的.
Very full now, so let's go hit up the market. This stall is called Taiwan Shui Ge, so that means handsome boy from Taiwan. It's not a big market, so I basically walked through the entire place. I'm most attracted to the vegetables. Firstly, because I freaking love vegetables, but secondly, I think that's what's most exciting to me about a wet market. Yes, the seafood is so fresh and that's really exciting too, but the range of vegetables, herbs, ingredients that they have on offer here is so much more than you get in a supermarket. Because supermarkets are about standard, consistency. At a wet market stall, they can basically stock whatever they can get their hands on. And so, this stall behind me, they have some really interesting things. I'm pretty inspired to make a lei cha fan, which is a Hakka dish. Maybe it's because I was thinking of my Ipoh and she was Hakka as well. But lei cha fan is one of my favorite foods in the world. It's a Hakka dish that is rice, various vegetables, usually meat, preserved radish, and then it's got this paste, kind of a soupy paste made with herbs, tea, nuts. It is really, really good. So I've never made it before. I'm gonna try making my own version. I'm obviously very prepared to buy a lot of things because I brought the biggest reusable bag known to man.
Auntie, I want 艾草.
How to buy?
我没有那么多啦，我这份就OK了。
OK，
你们有九层塔吗？你知道我要做什么吗？擂茶，我要啊，你知道。 She guessed exactly what I was cooking. That's a good start. Oh dear, it's very hard to choose. Everything looks very good. I'm like, that's the thing about coming here. It's like my brain is running with ideas. I'm like, oh, I could do this. I could take that and like grill it. I could pickle this. But no, I'm going to limit myself to one dish. So control yourself, Sarah, control. This is looking very interesting. These are fresh bolotti beans. I've never cooked them before. Maybe I've never even eaten them before. Fresh. So I'm going to ask the auntie if she has any suggestions on how to prepare these.
也很快就熟了。哦。啊，你快，你要滚一下都可以，五分钟它。哦，五分钟啊。Okay.
对。这个很好吃啊。啊，对，扒掉皮，然后切切掉地头。Okay，我拿这个。That's a kailan stem, so it's like a kailan that's been left to grow, so the stem kind of takes over. Which is fine with me because I love the stem of kailan. A lot of people think that wet markets are only good for like local Chinese ingredients, but they have a lot of Western ingredients as well, like this broccolini. Okay, how? Auntie's giving me a good deal, 3 for 10. How can I say no? This is mani tai.
This
is gochujang.
Gochujang. Oh.
Oh, this stall is damn happening with the music. I love it. I found the tofu. I got a free gift from the auntie. Oh, makes me feel so special. I love it. Last stop, I think. I need to get some preserved radish. Uncle says expensive things taste better. That's good salesmanship. That was so much fun. And although you might come to a market like this, and the uncles and aunties are a little bit grumpy, that's just how they look. They're actually so friendly. They're really helpful. They're very good with suggestions and advice on how to cook various ingredients, especially things you've never seen before. Like I bought a pack of leaves that are apparently the leaves of the goji berry plant, which I have never heard of or eaten. So I'm very excited to cook that. And I'm just in a very good mood. Okay, I'm back from the market, back home in my parents' house. This is the kitchen that I grew up in. Oh wait, not literally, I wasn't forced to sleep in the kitchen, I didn't have a bedroom. But coming back from Bukit Timah Market and ending up here is literally a journey I've done so many times as a kid. So it's fun to be doing it today. Today I'm going to be making a dish I have never ever cooked, but I have eaten so many times and I eat it very often. It's Hakka Thunder Tea Rice Lei Cha Fan. If you've never had it, it's a dramatic name for a very wholesome, hearty dish. It's rice with various vegetables, ingredients. Sometimes people put minced pork, fried tofu, and then it's topped with this really herby soup paste. So today I'm going to take those herbs I bought, the mugwort, the Thai basil, coriander, and mint, and I'll blend them up with some toasted peanuts and sesame seeds so it's nice and nutty and fragrant. And I'll throw that on to some rice, the fried tofu, I'm going to do the kailan stems, I'll saute the goji berry leaves, which I'm very excited about, and I'll blanch those fresh borlotti beans. Here I've got the peanuts, a lot of them, and sesame seeds. So the idea is that I'm going to toast these peanuts in a dry pan so that they get fragrant, but also so I can take the skins off.
How long do you typically toast?
It should take around 5 to 6 minutes. Do you think it's been 5 to 6 minutes? She's checking her watch.
Maybe 5 minutes.
5 minutes? Okay. But you know, you need to like watch it and smell it to be able to tell. It should smell really fragrant. And the skins should be starting to pop off, which is really what we want. Fragrant. I'm gonna let the peanuts cool and I'm gonna toast the sesame seeds instead. To be honest, this recipe is not like visually dynamic because most of it I'm just gonna be standing here in front of the stove sauteing or toasting different ingredients and then I'll put it together at the end. So is usually said to be a very challenging dish to be made, but I don't think it's challenging as much as it is tedious. It's definitely a labor of love. You're not going to make this for someone that you don't like because it involves a lot of steps, but those steps are pretty easy. Here are all the beautiful herbs from the market. My bountiful harvest. I've got the coriander, the mugwort, the Thai basil, and the mint. And with the exception of the mugwort, you can get the other herbs at a supermarket. And I've seen people make lei chao without mugwort. It's actually really common to leave it out. But mugwort, ai chao in Mandarin, is a very integral herb in Hakka cooking. There are dumplings called ngei ban, which are made with this herb. And it has this kind of medicinal, slightly bitter flavor, which can't really be replicated. So I was really happy to find it, and it kind of kickstarted this whole idea. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to pluck off all the nice herbs and leave any of the mulchy bits out. And instead of blanching them, which is what I would usually do if I was making an Italian-style pesto, I read that for this, you should sauté the herbs. So we're going to set that chlorophyll so it stays nice and green. If you use these raw, firstly, it won't taste the same, but secondly, it will turn brown after it's all blended and stuff. So we're going to sauté these in some oil and then set them aside. So I had to buy the whole bunch of mugwort, but I'm actually not going to use that much of it because, as I said, mugwort has a really bitter, intense flavor. And so I'm going to add it bit by bit when I'm blending, and I'll figure out if enough or if we need more. But what I don't want to do is whack in a whole bunch at the start and ruin the entire thing because it's inedibly bitter. Like even when it's freshly plucked, you can smell that medicinal quality to it. It almost smells a little bit like aniseed, like licorice, that slightly like numbing quality. Something about it reminds me of my grandmother. I don't know why you smell.
It's fun, yo.
Yeah, it smells a bit like medicated oil, but it's just that generic Chinese medicine smell, you know? I'm gonna do the roasted peanut sesame. In the time when dishes like this were invented and created and passed on from generation to generation, people didn't say 100 grams of sesame, 100 grams of peanut. You learned by watching people make it. And in this day and age, we don't really get that opportunity, but we can learn from trying it out on our own. So something like this, it's never going to be an exact recipe. It's the herbs you can get on the day. It's the proportion of the herbs that you feel like using. Do you want it more peanutty, more sesame? Use more of that. So it really is about tailoring it to your taste. So I'm going to do all of the Thai basil, the mint, and the coriander, which are roughly in equal proportions. I'll just do like half of the mugwort to start with. I've added some water just to help it blend, and then some salt. Mmm, it tastes pretty accurate. I probably could have used more herbs and less nuts, but it's my first time, it's okay. I can definitely taste the mugwort there. I'm deciding if I should add more. Should I? Maybe just a little bit. This is a Kai Lan stem.
What's your plan?
Wow, it's quite hard. So I'm gonna just take the skin off, peel it, because the skin is quite tough on this. And then I think I will cut it into little half moon shapes and sauté it. They taste very green and very fresh, almost a little bit sweet. It's actually sweeter than small Kai Lan, somehow. It has a nice buttery sweetness to it. Okay, now classic long beans. I'm just gonna cut them into sections and sauté them as well. Now this mysterious vegetable, which I have never encountered before, the goji berry leaves. The nice thing about going to the market is that when you encounter things that you have never seen before, you can ask the auntie or the uncle, the stall owner, how do you cook this? What dish does it work in? What technique should I use? And they usually have all the answers. So the auntie told me this is very nice. I just need to take the leaves off. Oh, there are thorns. I'm really glad I didn't just try and strip it. She said just take the leaves off and then give them a quick sauté. So thanks to Elizabeth's Googling, well done. We found out that these are actually called gaoki, which is a vegetable I have seen in the shops. I've never cooked with it. I'm not even sure if I've eaten it. So this is still a first. Apparently, they are a superfood. I mean, if goji berries are a superfood, I guess it's pretty logical to think that the leaves would be superfood. If you're making proper lei cha, you can definitely sauté these vegetables, whichever one you want, with minced garlic for that proper taste. I kind of want this to be clean. Also, my household is actually not very keen on garlic, so I'm going to leave it out and treat this like kind of like simple components of the final dish. The last vegetable I'm going to make is these fresh borlotti beans. They're so pretty inside.
You're matching the beans today.
Oh, am I? It's quite chic, right?
Yeah, I think they'd be great earrings.
It's giving... What?
Maybe a little bit.
How about your cuff?
Wow, your cuff. Oh. Arwen.
Arwen, wow. What a compliment. Okay. Some of these have started to sprout. They've got their little endosperm? Was it endosperm? Little tails sticking out. But I guess it's fine. Just like a really big sprout.
Anyway, people always have like sprouted grains and stuff.
Yes, yes. This is a very healthy dish. Superfood. We're doing sprouted grain, goji berry leaves, medicinal herbs. I could put this on the menu at like era one. The very last thing I'm going to stir fry is cai po, which is preserved radish. And this has bit of sweetness, saltiness, savoriness, and it's got a nice crunch, so we'll add it to every bowl. I'm gonna multitask because I'm really getting hungry. I'm gonna blanch the beans at the same time. Lei cha is like a symphony. Wow, I sound where am I going with this? Lei cha is like a symphony because you have a lot of flavor from the sauce for sure, but every element contributes something. You want to use good rice because the fragrance of the rice matters. You want to use the freshest vegetable because the bite, that nutty freshness comes through. The cai po, you want something that's nice and savory with a hint of sweetness. The nuts, you want them to be fragrant. Everything needs to be playing its part so that when you take a bite, everything works together. And that's why it's so delicious. Last, final thing that I have to prep. Oh my god, we've been here so long. This better be good. I've got some tau kwa, which is extra firm tofu. Just gonna cut it into cubes and then fry it until it's crispy. This has been very fun, don't get me wrong. It's really fun, but the kitchen is hot. I've been doing this for hours. I'm really ready to eat, so come on tofu, work with me. We're ready to assemble, finally! I really like the nuttiness of brown rice in this dish. And then on top of the rice, I just lay out the various ingredients, the vegetables, the tofu, the cai po, and then that herbal nutty paste goes on. I really like this dish soupy, on the soupier side. So I pour some hot water all over it because I love a soup and rice situation. And then it's time to taste. Tastes like the real thing. I mean, I know it is the real thing, but it being my first time making this dish, I'm quite impressed. You get the crunch and the different textures of all the different vegetables, the different flavors, the sweetness, and then that savory hit from the cai po. And that herbal paste, it just tastes so delicious and nutty. You can taste all the components. I am very happy with this. That was the very first episode of Market Adventures, which I hope can be a long series, not just in Singapore, in Malaysia, and hopefully across the world, because I think there's no better way to get to know a place and its people than visiting the markets in it. To discover the flavors, to discover the foods, and discover the sights and sounds of that place. So, I want to hear from you. Let me know what you thought of this. Let me know if you have any markets to recommend. And let me know where you think I should go. And hopefully, till the next episode, see you!